I am privileged to welcome you all into the third edition of Aurum City Literature Festival. It is organized by SGR Knowledge Foundation in association with GH Raisoni University, powered by Raisoni Group of Institutions. It is a platform that celebrates wisdom, narratives, notions, and experience from all walks of life. Having said that, it is thrilling to be here with you all today. I am Nidhi Baghel, delighted to be your anchor for today's session. The Oyster and the Pearl, Surviving and Thriving After the Suicide Loss by Dr. Nandini Murali, in conversation with Dr. Rosina Rana. Dr. Nandini Murali is a person with diverse professional interests and engagements. She is an author, translator, certified life coach focusing in loss and transition, mental health promotion and suicide prevention activist, and a diversity, equity, and inclusion professional. She compiled, translated in English, and edited the world's first signature edition of the Bhagavad Gita. Her areas of professional interests include LGBTQIA+ issues, mental health, resilience and well-being, trauma, literacy and education, suicide prevention and postvention interventions for survivors of suicide loss, sexual and reproductive health rights, gender, masculinities, and gender-based violence. She has developed a set of 12 life skills modules for LGBTQIA+ youth and affirmative approaches to counseling LGBTQIA+ clients, a resource manual for counselors. Her lived experience of suicide loss inspired her in 2018 to establish SPEAK, an initiative of MS Chelamuthu Trust and Research Foundation, Madurai, to change conversations on suicide and promote mental health. In 2020, she established Speak to Us, a mental health helpline for people in psychological distress. An ardent advocate of building and fostering resilience, she and Kate Kiesel, US-based trauma therapist, have launched Bounce Forward, a cross-cultural coalition led by individuals with lived experiences that works towards a radical global change in healing of trauma. Currently, Dr. Nandini Murali Ma'am is the Vice President, Learning and Research in Avatar Group, Chennai. Passionate about wildlife photography, she likes nothing better than wandering through the forests with her camera. Eager to share her love for the wild with young people, she initiated Voices of the Wild, a group of Madurai-based school children who discover nature and conservation through wildlife photography. Dr. Nandini Murali has published both fiction and non-fiction. Left Behind is her fifth book, and she has just completed her next book. It is an honor to have you with us, Dr. Nandini Murali Ma'am. And this gets even more delightful as we have Dr. Rosina Rana Ma'am, who will be in conversation with her as the moderator. Dr. Rosina Rana Ma'am is a seasoned counselor and life coach. Currently, she is associated with Raisoni Group of Institutions as manager, training and development. She is also the director of a counseling center set up in Nagpur. After completing her PhD in clinical psychology, she has helped a large number of people, including 1 lakh students, 5,000 teachers and 500 parents, and many working professionals create their own runway to peace and success. In her professional legacy, she holds many awards and accolades to her credit. Some of the most prominent awards include Outstanding HR Trainer and Psychological Counselor by Higher Education Ministry Government of Telangana, Nation Builder Award by Rotary Club of Nagpur, and the Women Achievers Award by Ismailia Helping Society. I once again welcome you both, ma'am. Also, before moving ahead, I would like to take a moment and acknowledge support of Westland Publication, as their association is valuable to OCLF. Now, my dear audience, you're about to experience a conversation between two very dynamic individuals. So without skipping a moment, I humbly invite Dr. Rosina Rana Ma'am to lead us ahead. Please give a round of applause for Dr. Nandini Ma'am and Dr. Rosina Ma'am.
Dr. Nandini Murali. She lost her friend to suicide and her changed forever. As she struggled to find her feet and begin to live again, she discovered that survivors of suicide loss are unheard and unseen. Their needs and concerns are not recognized. Death of a dear one is something many of us have experienced lately. But death by suicide keeps you grappling with so many questions. Why this happened? Why I loneliness,
she writes about the overwhelming feeling of confusion, anger, shame, pain, loneliness, and guilt that survivors of suicide loss face. The way she brings out the subject out of the closet and talks about the feeling of 4S, shame, secrecy, silence, and stigma of suicide loss, will only compel you to finish the book till the end. A Chronicle of Love and Loss, Left Behind is an inspirational story of transforming pain into purpose, healing and transforming through loss, building resilience and discovering newer meaning in life. Ma'am Nandini Murali is with us today to talk on her extremely captivating book, Left Behind, Surviving Suicide Loss. So ma'am, we would like to know about your journey, how you refuse to be a victim, and the metaphor that you use, oyster and the pearl.
Thank you, Dr. Rosina, for this conversation with me. Until suicide happened to me, happened in my life, I always thought it was something that happened to other people, to other families, not in my family. I believed I was immune to it. My only brush with suicides were, you know, news reports in the media, which were obviously are very sensationalized. And of course, when I was in school, a very dear friend's father died of suicide. And I still remember then, although this is all in retrospect, all this gyan, I still remember my friend's family refused to talk about it. It was almost as if that person itself was erased. And that was something which stayed with me. And also later on, I met another woman who had lost her husband to suicide. And I still remember this was years after the incident happened. And she was still carrying so much of anger, resentment, hostility, and guilt. I don't know why these examples lived on in my memory. Perhaps I don't know when it was time for me to deal with the suicide of my spouse. These were examples which came up to my mind, and I said, I do not want to be like this. That was very clear. How I wanted to be, I had no idea. But let me just give you a little context, because that perhaps might give you a little more insight into why I refused to be a victim, why it was so important for me to get out of this victim mindset. In my professional capacity, I work largely with marginalized and disempowered communities, LGBT issues, people with infected and affected by HIV/AIDS, people with disabilities, every kind of marginalization. And what struck me even then, and this I'm talking from the early 90s onwards, it was how people impacted, took charge of their own lives and refused to play the victim. And that was something for me which was very important, the power of lived experiences to drive change, to influence change. And I saw every kind of marginalization, but people refused to be the victim. So for me, the victim mindset was very disempowering. You know, it didn't make any sense for me to ask, why me? You know, it was, why not me? You know, how should I deal with this? Not by, you know, all those rona dona, all that's like, oh, poor me. And so what am I going to do? My question was, I had no control over what happened to me. I had no control over my husband's death by suicide. I was not responsible for what happened, but I had every responsibility to choose how I was going to respond. And that was the way forward for me. It was not just important to survive, but I also wanted to thrive. But that said, I must tell you, I have to be very honest. The transformation didn't happen overnight. The first year after the suicide, it was one step forward and a million steps backward. I think there was not a day in the first year I didn't weep. I mean, when I would start crying, there were triggers everywhere. There were memories everywhere. So literally, I was navigating a landmine of memories. But even then, I still remember on the day of the tragedy, the day of the funeral was to happen the next day. It was late night and my whole nervous system was in a state of shock. I still remember holding on to my mother's hand and asking her, Ma, we'll get out of this, won't we? I felt I was in a deep pit, and here I was trying to crawl out of that deep pit with nothing but except a deep desire to get out. How, I didn't know. But the desire was there, the will was there, and the refusal to play the victim. But that said, at several points in my time, I just felt I was a victim. I felt very vulnerable. So for me, vulnerability is strength. So it is, for me, the journey has been about owning my vulnerability and also discovering my strengths. The two exist for me side by side.
You can hear her say such a powerful things that she said just now, and so is powerful book that you will be holding on and talking and reading till the end. You will not be able to just leave it. We all are so touched with what you spoke just now.
Thank you.
And a little bit about oyster and the pearl.
Yes, the oyster and the pearl, this really happened. This is probably the last chapter of my book. And I remember the first year, just a month before Murli's, my late husband's first anniversary, a friend of mine from Bangalore, she came home and she said she wanted to go to Dhanushkodi. Dhanushkodi is a tiny little coastal hamlet in almost the southernmost tip of the country. And so I said, yeah, let's go. And the sea there is very wild. It's completely unspoiled. And it's almost the place where the Bay of Bengal meets the Indian Ocean and the Arabian Sea. All this, it's a sangam there, and it's a turquoise blue, emerald green, teal blue sea, and it's absolutely gorgeously wild. I was walking on the seashore, and there was this fisherman who was mending nets, and he came up to me and he said, "I don't know why, I just want to give this to you." And it was an oyster shell with seven brightly shining pearls embedded there. He said, "I just got it from the sea for you." And that for me was a very powerful metaphor, because I felt since the suicide happened, I felt I was, I had been thrown into an ocean of grief. I didn't think I would find land at all. I didn't think I would see the shore at all. I remember asking my uncle, my dad's brother, who actually inspired me to write the book. I said, "Will I ever reach the shore?" I still remember him telling me, "Trust me, one day you will." And here I was, 1 year later, I found myself on the seashore. So it was like for me finding my bhoomi, finding my ground at the end of 1 year. And we all know the oyster forms pearls only when it is deeply hurt, only when it is wounded. So for me, here I was at the end of 1 year, I had discovered these pearls of wisdom. And this is the last chapter of my book, The Oyster and the Pearl. I have this quote by Federico Fellini. He says, all art is autobiographical. The pearl is the oyster's autobiography. If there's no irritation, no pearls. So for me, the pearls of wisdom, what I had gained, were very symbolic of my transformation. Yeah.
So when you are into a deep pain and in trauma and something of this kind happens and you feel this was just meant to happen, and that you feel that this was like destined, and I'm right time at the right place. So Nandini, we would like to know the whole process of writing.
Yeah, this is a question I'm very fond of. I've always been expressed myself through writing. I think I started writing when I was 8 years old. And since then, it's been a very deep engagement with writing for me. So this is not the first challenge I had to deal with in life. Life has thrown up several challenges at me, each one worse than the other, I would say. But that's how I've emerged as who I am today. So I'm very deeply grateful. For in every challenge, I feel there is a seed of possibility, of transformation. It is embedded, it is hidden. It's up to us to be able to discover that. So when this tragedy happened, I said I needed to write about it. There was no doubt about it. And it was my uncle, my dad's brother. I think the day after the tragedy, when he called me, he said, there's a book out there and you should write that book. But it seemed too early to write. So I said, yeah. And he had sent me two beautiful emails, which I've also reproduced in the book. So immediately after the tragedy, I began to journal, you know, write whatever I free associate, whatever I felt like. And for me, that journal formed the first part of my book. My book consists of four parts. The first part is the tragedy, what happened. The second part is my attempts to make meaning of what happened. The third part consists of talking to other people impacted by suicide loss who were very willing to share their stories. And the last part is the transformation. You know, making meaning out of this, finding that, you know, finding those pearls of wisdom. And it was like a manthan, you know, it was this huge churning. And we all know the story of the churning of the ocean in our Puranas. It's only when the ocean is churned that the amrita or the elixir, the nectar emerges. No churning, no nectar. So for me, it was like finding that pot of elixir at the end of 1 year. That said, the first year I couldn't write. Every time I sat down to write, tears would flow. Tears literally would fall on the keyboard. And Q-W-E-R-T-Y, I think, were effectively erased. So I didn't make any attempt to write. I tried, but I couldn't. But then something told me that this was not the right time for it. What I did instead was beginning to read on the subject of suicide, suicide loss. And I remember even 15 days after the tragedy, after the ceremonies were all over, when everyone went back to their own lives and I was left sitting in a rubble. You know, it was like as if a huge earthquake measuring something on a Richter scale which could not be measured had rocked my life. There was rubble everywhere and I'm looking, sitting, oh my God, what do I do? Now, how do I survive? I have to first survive, let alone thrive. A Google search suddenly threw up a word called postvention. I think I'm reasonably well informed because of my professional, the work I do. Postvention, what was that? I had heard of prevention. That was when I realized what postvention was, and for the next 15 days, I read up everything Google had to throw up. And it was like I was possessed by some demonic energy. And I was very sick in the initial 3-4 months, the acute grief. I was experiencing every physical, psychological symptom of acute grief. And so there was this, I read up everything. And I remember there was one book written by a survivor of suicide loss. It was No Time to Say Goodbye. I just ordered it in Amazon and it arrives the next day. It was written by Carla Fine, who is a journalist and a suicide prevention activist who lives in the US. I started reading the book from cover to cover and my eyes began to open wider and wider in amazement because there were so many coincidences. Carla's husband, who died of a suicide, was also a well-known urologist like my husband, and he lived in Manhattan. Carla was a journalist, and again, I was a former independent journalist. Too many similarities, and oh my gosh, at the end of it, I felt if there's one person who understood me, it was Carla. And then I immediately emailed her because her email was there. I thought she's not going to write back. To my surprise, in the next 5 minutes, I get an email for her saying, yes, this is going to be a tough journey, but I'm sure you're going to reach the other side. Since then, she's become an exceedingly close friend. I mean, I consider her my soul sister across the continents. But that was when I decided, okay, I want to see if someone has written about being impacted by suicide loss in the Indian context. There was nothing. And therefore, I said, I need to be the change I wanted to see. Because for me, it was very, very obvious that there was so much of stigma around suicide. Because of the stigma, there was so much of shame. You know, even I felt very ashamed, as if I've done something wrong. Oh my God. And being a woman, I think the gendered dimensions of suicide were very, very obvious to me. There was so much of silence. Nobody wanted to talk about it. I have been through other kinds of non-suicidal bereavement. My own experience and that of others told me that there's so much of support, so much of empathy for other kinds of death. But if it's a death by suicide, there is an empathy deficit. People who came to condole me wanted to know what happened. Why did it happen? I don't know.
What were you doing? Where were you?
Exactly. Couldn't you prevent it? Didn't you see it happening? I just felt, and it was like they were judge and jury, and I had the law enforcement ask me all sorts of questions. That was very traumatizing. That was very re-traumatizing. And everyone wanted to tell me, okay, tell me what happened. There would be gossip sessions at home. Little people stand sitting in knots and you know what happened? Do you know why this happened? Etc., etc. So I said, it was very difficult not to feel like a victim then. But I said, no, I wanted to be the change I wanted to see. I think this Mahatma Gandhiji's famous quotation, be the change you want to see. I said, okay, I'm going to stand up and talk not only for myself, but for millions of people across the globe impacted by this horrendous tragedy. Trust me, I won't wish it even on my worst enemy. But therefore, and this narrative, Rosina, I wanted it to be a very empowering narrative. I wanted to be, I did my research for almost 2 years thoroughly. I wanted to bring in all the perspectives. And I felt that preventing suicide is everybody's business. It's a huge public health challenge globally. And it needs a convergence of different stakeholders. And in that, people with a lived experience like me, people who've lost a loved one to suicide, people who have attempted suicide and have survived, we have a huge role to play. So that said, it took me 1 year to write the book. I once again went to the US. I wanted to visit my uncle because he wanted me to be there with him. And he said, let's start writing the book. I said, no, I'm not going to write the book. It's just not going to happen. So I still remember we sat across the table and made note cards. Every chapter, even the title heading, the book title, everything is as it was decided. And he said, okay, tell me, first chapter, what do you want to write? And then he would note it down in note cards, you know, the kind we make for our PhD thesis. And that was how. And then when I came back from the US, the next day I started writing the book and I just started flowing. People ask me, is it re-traumatizing for you to tell that story? No, not at all. It was re-traumatizing when people asked me, why did it happen? How did it happen? Blah, 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 blah. It was not re-traumatizing. In fact, it was very joyful when I was writing this because writing itself was very healing. And I felt when I was writing from a space of deep joy, deep quiet, that shantam, which they say. So, which was for me very therapeutic, very, very healing. And it took me about 2 years to write the book. And I remember writing the last line of the book. Monumental sorrows can be left behind one step at a time on Murali's third death anniversary. And it was almost at the last chapter for me, I just felt I downloaded that information from somewhere. And I almost at some point, I felt he wanted to tell this, all these truths to the rest of the world. So that was how the book was written, and writing it was an incredibly transformative, deeply healing, and a very, very joyful experience.
Lovely. Nandini, we just want to hear you, but just listen and listen to you the way you are speaking, because all the young people sitting here, maybe we have experienced something of this kind with the things that are going around us some point of time, or maybe we have met somebody who is going through such a thing. And there's so much of learning from what you are talking, and even just writing the thing can also be a coping way of coping. So that was lovely. And not just the book. We have a book now, the Indian version, not just the book, but also she started with a trust, Speak to Us. So I would like you to speak little more about it.
Again, this is part of my healing journey. On the first year of Murali's anniversary, I set up a little initiative called Speak. I wanted to create safe, supportive spaces where people could have informed conversations about suicide. One reason why suicide is not spoken about is there are no safe, supportive spaces. Whom do you ask? What do you ask? You know, so many questions. So Speak is an initiative of a well-known mental health NGO in Madurai. This is the MS Chellamuthu Trust and Research Foundation. And over the years, we've been doing a lot of awareness and sensitization for different stakeholders, young people like you, for instance, schools, colleges, teachers, law enforcement, media, on responsible reporting of suicide, or for judiciary, for law enforcement. How do you provide sensitivity for policymakers, for NGOs? And a year about in 2020, we also set up a helpline called Speak to Us for people in various kinds of psychological distress. And then, of course, now my book, which I use as an advocacy tool for, you know, telling people that, listen, this is a huge public health challenge and we need to have the sensitivity and the informed perspectives with which to address it. If we know someone who has been impacted by suicide loss or someone who is suicidally ideated, how do we provide support? What kind of support can we provide? Because preventing suicide is everybody's business, not just that of mental health professionals alone. I know Dr. Bhave is here, and I'm sure he would agree with me. You just can't leave it to mental health professionals alone, say, oh, it's none of my business. And I'm sure Rosina, as a mental health professional yourself, I'm sure you'd agree with it. So, and right now my concern is on providing postvention services for people who've lost a loved one to suicide. Yeah.
Lovely. I absolutely agree. And also Dr. Sudhir Bhave, who is with us, and we are honored to have him here with us. And See, people, I mean, talking to the right people is important, but also what to talk and how to talk is also something that we need to know. There are things not to talk. Yeah, so in her book, she's written a chapter on what not to say, because that may completely backfire. So it's because we have a young, the hall is full of young people here. So I think if you throw a little light on what not to say and what to say, that will be really a great help, because everybody, this is our business. This is our mission, and it should be. Looking at the amount of depression and suicide itself happening in young people. So, yeah. Nandini.
Yes, Rosina. There's a huge, this chapter I loved writing, what to say and what not to say to someone who has been impacted by suicide loss. One is that I'm sure all of us, given the spiraling rates of suicide, we are going to come across someone in our family, in our friend circle, in our colleague circle, who's lost a loved one to suicide. Offer unconditional support and empathy. Don't ask, how did it happen? Why did it happen? Tell me. You know, just be, offer unconditional support. If that person chooses to share with you, he or she will. That's a choice. It's their privacy, and you need to give it to them. Don't demand to know why, what happened. You know, don't let your inquisitiveness get the better of you, and don't use it, and please avoid using it as a gossip item. You know what? This suicide happened in their family, and you know the reasons for it, because as Dr. Bhave would endorse, as Dr. Rosina would endorse, suicide is multifactorial. So many factors converge which drives a person to kill themselves. It's not one reason, and very often the media, I just find headlined love failure or failure in exams. Dr. Bhave, those are triggers, right? Those are the final things which really pushes up, but that's not a cause. Triggers are not causes. They are multifactorial. So we need to understand, one of the things SPEAK does is we conduct gatekeeper trainings for young people like you. How do you identify early warning signs of suicide, and therefore how can you help? So it's this, you know, I just would say, like, give a very small example here. I share space. I love dogs, and they're a major part of my book, Malli and Minnal. Malli in Tamil means jasmine, the jasmine flower. She's almost white. And Minnal is, in Tamil, it means lightning. Malli and Minnal have been the best grief therapists. In the first year, whenever I would cry, I would have meltdowns. Malli would get on to my...
your doggies, yeah.
So. Yeah, they would, she'd put her paws around my neck and lick my face. Malli doesn't understand language. She doesn't even need to, but Malli understands what it means to be there unconditionally. If a dog could have this sensitivity, why can't we humans, you know, we are supposed to be the pinnacle of creation. Why are we so insensitive? Why do we hurt people? Why do we exclude those people who most need our help? So.
Yeah. Very well said. When it comes to language, I read in your book that if somebody says that I understand your pain, which is a very common thing when we go to any funeral and we say we understand your pain, even that, we don't know what the person is going through. So even that is maybe not an appropriate thing to say. I mean, it's so sensitive. And maybe you can just say, I'm here for you.
Yeah.
So these are very, very finer things that we need to be very, very cautious about. And also, Doctor, I mean, I have seen, it's so painful to see that very trivial things sometimes are shown in the newspaper, or maybe it is there. Because I read about a boy long back, not during the pandemic. In pandemic, everybody needs a phone and has a phone. The boy was denied a phone, cell phone, and then he committed suicide. This was maybe 4 or 5 years ago. So, I mean, would you like to tell us that the trivial talk sometimes, in your book also you wrote about a husband asking, is this a right way to do to the wife? And wife goes in the room and she commits suicide. So, a little trivial conversations can also lead to something like this. I mean, I have a question. Does this happen?
I would think these are triggers. These are not causes, but unfortunately, I think people confuse triggers with causes, especially the media. They ask, why did it happen? What is that one reason for suicide? As someone impacted by suicide loss, I know there is not one reason. There are several factors, risk factors, you know, when multiple risk factors converge. We have someone taking this very extreme step. Lots of students do badly in their exams. Lots of students so-called fail, but not all of them, think of ending their lives. So there are risk factors, multiple risk factors, and there are triggers. I think both are very, very different. So what would I do? I would say, just as we have risk factors, we have protective factors like a very close-knit family, our own inner resilience, and having a strong support system. I think we need to build on increasing the protective factors, especially young people like you. Invest in strengthening your protective factors so that your protective factors far outweigh the risk factors. Risk is going to be there, stress is going to be there, but how do you deal with stress? You know, for me, I find it very good to distinguish. There are things I can control. There are things I can't control. But there are many things I can choose to respond to. And that is where I would focus. Like, for instance, after this tragedy, I could have gone into the rabbit hole of despair and depression and say my life ended. Or I can say, okay, now I have to survive and I also have to thrive. This connection, my thriving, my four books were written during this period. I think creativity was at my best. I'm now doing the kind of work I'm very passionate about. So it's actually thriving, and I'm a new me right now. You know, I think the old Nandini died with Murli. You know, I think this is a very new Nandini, very, very strong Nandini. I was just telling Rosina before the session, after facing this crisis, I just feel I can handle anything in this world. I don't know, it gives you that strength, that resilience, and that equanimity. I don't know, if maybe this hadn't happened, I would still be, if something happened, I would be really shattered, exactly. But now, yes, I do get shattered. I'm not saying I'm invincible. I still am vulnerable, but I know I can handle it. It's just that some inner strength, when you've seen the worst, I think you can handle anything, really. Trust me.
Yeah. So every pain and every time you face an incident which is unpleasant, that gives you more strength. That gives you more strength. So, and you bounce back. The resilience is there in place. And you really feel that I can go far and really without any fear. So that's not just surviving, but thriving and really going places. And today we have you with us, all the young people talking. When it comes to language, there's one more thing that we were talking about. And that is when we hear somebody committed a suicide, and I'm using this word committed a suicide because that's how we talk. And actually, it should be death by suicide. So this is a little change, but means a lot. Because committed, when we say committed, it is a crime. And no more it is a crime, right? So it is death by suicide. And we people, we need to be very sensitive when whatever language we use around people who have experienced this or going through this.
Zina, can I just add a bit? See, the decriminalization of suicide does two things. We're not endorsing suicide. We're not saying it's okay. But we're saying it's no longer a crime. It's a public health issue. So when you say it's no longer a crime, until this act was enacted in IPC 309, I think Dr. Bhavi was just talking to me about it. If someone even attempted suicide, that was an offense. But now we are saying there could be several mental health conditions which could drive a person to suicide. Therefore, enable that person access support, get help. The other thing we are saying is suicide is not a crime because those impacted by suicide laws like me, we need the kind of support from people, from community to rebuild our lives. So in that sense, we are decriminalizing it and we're saying it's a global public health challenge. By a public health challenge, it not only impacts an individual, the family, it impacts the society, it impacts colleagues, it impacts the nation, it impacts the world. You know, those are those huge statistics. And also because I also feel statistics are numbers. They don't tell the whole story. Behind every statistic is someone like me whose lives have been changed completely by this tragedy. And therefore, we need to come together to address this.
Nandini, women survivors... It's tough really for them because there are two families, one their own, other their in-laws. And loss of husband by suicide is something that she has to really go through with two families. And how do in-laws, forget about relatives and the extended families, but in-laws, how what happens with women mainly? So, and how she should be kind of dealing and addressing all this?
Lovely question. This is something I've engaged so deeply with. I think a death by suicide has very gendered dimensions. By gendered dimensions, I mean women who have lost either a husband to suicide or a child to suicide. They are worst affected. One is because of the gender, because, you know, in traditional societies, women the blame and shame is attached to women. And also because suicide, there's so much of stigma, shame and secrecy around suicide. Women are supposed to be traditionally seen as custodians of culture and family values, family honor, izzat, very, very important. So when a woman loses a husband to suicide or a child to suicide, it's like a dereliction of your duty. What were you doing? Didn't you see it coming? So I find women disproportionately impacted as survivors of suicide loss. It results in changes in family dynamics. Even if they don't blame her directly, implicitly, indirectly, there is this thing that you could have prevented it. As once again, when Rosina and I, we were talking, we can't be responsible for another person's life, even if it is our spouse or children. We can provide support, we can be there for them. And sometimes despite our best intentions, when such things happen, and in the ultimate analysis, I feel each of us is truly responsible only for our lives. And I think these are larger issues we need to consider. And yes, the change in family dynamics, the disruption. In some cases, the marital family completely disown the woman. Those are huge challenges. And these are secondary losses, which actually worsen our primary loss. And this makes the grief so disenfranchised. What do I mean? If you've lost a loved one to suicide, I can't tell people, you know, people will, I want to invent socially acceptable reasons for the, I had it myself. I wanted to say, oh, my husband died of, you know, a heart attack or some very nice socially acceptable thing. So this actually, you know, and we in life, we need to be able to bring our whole selves. We can't be fake. We can't keep playing this double game.
And how long? Even if we are doing that, we'll not be like happy doing it. Yeah. Just for the sake of society, we may do it. But how long? There's a big struggle inside. There's a mental conflict. So it's such a difficult time when to talk to people. See, we are already fighting with our own grief. And then there are people around makes it really more difficult.
Absolutely. And this is when this victimization happens. That's one when we say we need to be authentic. And when we are a victim, I think we give our power away. So for me, writing this book was, I really want to call it an act of transgression, an act of rebellion. It was a way of reclaiming my power to tell my story the way I want to, not the way society wants us to. And also tell people, wake up. This is, you have a responsibility to, in supporting people, in preventing this kind of thing. And I think writing is a very powerful way of changing mindsets and attitudes. That said, I'm not very naive that overnight things can be changed. But I think writing this book for me was throwing a pebble, maybe in an ocean, but the pebble has been thrown. Yeah,
and we can see the ripple effects right here.
Oh, that is so beautiful.
I think everybody sitting in this hall is really touched, and there's a little shift that has happened, and the message has gone really clearly across the table. And I'm sure everybody will do that little bit to help people around to understand them. The last question from my side is, there are no quick fix methods to cope. So what would you kind of give a message or suggest people how to really come out of this whole thing? Even if you're having the suicidal thoughts or you're dealing a loss.
Okay. This is again a lovely question. I agree with you. There are no band-aids, no quick fixes, no magic solutions. For someone who is suicidally ideated, I would say that please seek appropriate early help. Look for professionals, mental health professionals who can support you. Get your family involved in this. Create that circle of friends. And I've known some of my very close friends have been suicidally ideated. They've attempted suicide. Brilliant people. And once I started speaking, they came up to me and said, oh, you know what? We've also attempted, but now we've sought therapy and now we are well. I would have never guessed. I said, oh, why are you telling me now? They said, no, but once you started speaking, we got that courage to say, oh, it's okay. I think we need to normalize conversations on suicide, both prevention and for someone who's been impacted by suicide loss. It's a horrendous tragedy. I can also say that unless you've had a similar experience, you can come close to it, but you can never really understand it. Therefore, look up for people who really, really dealt with such difficult situations and transformed. There are enough books available, not only suicide loss, but other kinds of loss. I think this is one beautiful two books I would strongly recommend for anyone. One is Viktor Frankl's Man's Search for Meaning. Frankl was a brilliant psychiatrist, and he was at the Auschwitz concentration camp for 4 years. The horrors and what he does after that, he loses his wife who was pregnant, he loses his parents, his sister, but then he survives the camp. I doubt if I would have survived those horrors for even half an hour. And then he goes out and say, when the worst happens, you have a choice on how to respond. And there is this other book, two books called Choice and Gift. It's by Edith Eger. Edith Eger is 92 years old. She's the oldest surviving Auschwitz survivor. And she talks about how she transformed. And she says, when something horrendous happens, you have a choice to respond. I had no control over what happened, but I have every control in how to respond. These are very, very immensely transforming books. Fantastically. And she's got enough YouTube videos as well. So I think, and it's up to us, take responsibility for our lives. As I said, we have choice at every stage. There are situations beyond our control, And there are situations where we have every control. Speaking for myself, I think one of the biggest supports in my healing journey has been my birth family. I'm blessed to be born in, I think I probably have the best parents in the world. And I have a loving brother and a beautiful sister-in-law and my nephew and my mama, to whom I have dedicated the book, and my parents. My mama is 98 years old, and I can still have the most beautiful conversations with him. These have been my oxygen and my life support. And I have very close friends who are family to me. You know, and friends who really stood by me throughout the journey, and my uncle who lives in the US, who's actually been my therapist, my uncle, my parent figure, my best friend, my editor, my writing coach. In fact, I would want to dedicate this talk to my uncle, my parents, and my mama. So, you know,
family and friends, write and talk, is what I understand from what you're talking right now. And yeah, don't suffer in silence, but don't suffer in silence. Find a mentor, family is around you. You may find right next to you. Just talk to them. I'll be sharing some helpline numbers also. But before that, if there's any question from you guys, anybody in the audience, the listeners,
it means a lot to hear this from you.
Yes.
Of course, that was one of my favorites. Absolutely, yeah. I completely agree with you.
Okay, there's a question. Would you like to have the mic? Your name, please.
Yeah. Prevention is what you do before something happens. Postvention is after the whatever has happened. In this case, after the suicide has happened, how do you help those impacted by suicide loss, those who are left behind? How do you help them to rebuild their lives? What are the skills? What are the kind of support? You know, one thing which has really helped me is being a member in support groups for survivors of suicide loss. You know, that is something which we at Speak also promote. So when I'm in a support group where I meet other people impacted by loss, suicide loss, not other kinds of loss, it helps me realize I'm not alone. And when I listen to their journeys, how they've dealt with it, or when I share my story, I also offer hope and support to others. You know, if I can do it, so can you. If you can do it, so can he. That's how it goes. You know, it multiplies. And sometimes if there is a diagnosable depression, I think we need to sort of refer them to mental health professionals for appropriate, adequate treatment. So that's also a thing. So essentially, we are talking about rebuilding one's life. You know, it's about actually reinventing oneself. What's happened has happened. So now what next? So, and what are the skills, the strategies, the support which needs to be in place? And it also needs, we are talking about ecosystem change. You know, the larger ecosystem has also to be supportive. If at work I've lost a loved one to suicide, how can my colleagues help me at work? Not just say, oh, something terrible has happened, and not use it as a water cooler gossip, a site for water cooler gossip. You know, but what can you do? What can, say for instance, if a student has lost a parent to suicide, how can teachers support? How can classmates support? How can the school support? You know, what is the larger system? How do we sensitize law enforcement while they're doing their investigations? How do you be more sensitive? How do you need to tell them, see, your insensitivity really traumatizes people, you know? How do you do your work, whatever you're supposed to be doing, but do it with some sensitivity and compassion? You know, I think we need to have those compassionate conversations, which I think is very important. I know this is not an easy subject to talk about, but I think we need to have those candid conversations, those fierce conversations. We can't just pretend to ignore the elephant in the room and think, that elephant will just go away. It won't. It's in the room. So we need to acknowledge it. Ultimately, no matter how much support you have, I think the final analysis, you have to do the work. So I'm not saying just because there is support, you can just sit back and do nothing. When you have lovely support, like for instance, in this room, I just feel everyone is so responsive and so sensitive to what I'm talking. I feel I'm very heard, valued, and validated. While that is very, very important, I think it's equally important for me to tell this group, hey guys, this is the issue. This is what happens. So can we amp up our sensitivity and compassion? Can we do something? There is this elephant. So what can we do to address it? So in the ultimate analysis, each one has to do that for themselves. You know, otherwise you're just getting into the victim mode. The dividing line is very, very thin, where you get into the victim mode and where you just go off. So ultimately, you have to ask yourself, what am I doing? Is this good for me? So what can I do to get out of this? We could probably talk a little after this session.
And everybody, everybody sitting in this room, as you said, Nandini, is now that it has triggered, the sensitive antenna is on, and whenever you see somebody around with this kind of a thing, or maybe you experience yourself, you will remember this session and how to really provide support and give support to your own self. Yeah, so that is something really we have learned today, and feel a little empowered, everybody here. And self-help groups definitely helps, but it's not still so prevalent, I feel. Alcoholic Anonymous, we see groups, so many groups, we have so many clubs and social clubs. But yes, for suicide prevention or helping suicide loss, this kind of self-help groups really needs a radical step, a drastic step. And Dr. Bhave is here, so I'm just looking at him because he's mostly people are here from Nagpur, and everybody knows Dr. Bhave, and so I'm looking at him for something of that scale and level. Very humble beginning, but yes, there has to be some beginning somewhere. So Nandini, I think when you'll pick up the book, see, we have really touched with every moment that was spent in this room. When you pick the book, if you have gone through the experience, you will feel that this is your own story. If you have not gone through that level of grief, any level of pain you have gone through, you will be so connected with the book. So thank you so much, Nandini, and thank you everybody for being here and spending time with us. And it was lovely talking to you, Nandini.
Thank you. Thank you, Rosina, for your sensitivity and your perspectives. I really loved the conversation with you. And thank you, everyone. I know, as I said earlier, I just felt so heard, so supported, and there was such a connect. Thank you so much for showing up the way you did. It meant a lot to me. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Nandini ma'am and Rosina ma'am, for enlightening us. It was really a very, very heart-touching session. I could really relate to whatever the lessons you gave to us. There was a lot of learning to learn. Now that we are towards the end of this session, I would like to thank Dr. Nandini Murli ma'am and Dr. Rosina Rana ma'am for joining us today. We wish we get to hear you both all over again and be equally enlightened as we are today. And for my dear massive audience, I am sure that today you will take an enriched version of yourself back home, just the way I am. Thank you so much for joining us, and thank you very much.
Vision Beyond.